Although Richard Stockton at first did not like politics, he committed much of his life to public service. Stockton was born in 1730 and grew up at the family home, Morven, in New Jersey. He went to school in West Nottingham Academy and later at the College of New Jersey, which became Princeton University. Following his graduation, he went to study in the law office of David Ogden in Newark. When Richard was 22, he married Annis Boudinot. Their first child, Julia, later married Dr. Benjamin Rush, a signer of the Declaration from Pennsylvania. Stockton became an attorney and opened a law office in Princeton, where he became well known for his consideration and coolness under fire. One of the trustees of the College of New Jersey called him a gentleman of genius and learning, and you may assuredly depend upon his intelligence as a person of the strictest probity. He is an eminent lawyer and at the head of his profession in the Providence of New Jersey. Initially, Stockton was not interested in politics. In 1764, he wrote, "The public is generally unthankful, and I never will become a servant of it, till I am convinced that by neglecting my own affairs, I am doing more acceptable service to God and man." Stockton spent 2 years in Great Britain serving his alma mater, the College of New Jersey. When Stockton returned to the colonies, he was appointed by the Crown to the New Jersey Congress, which was called the Royal Judiciary and Executive Council of New Jersey. While living in Morven, Stockton worked to build up his family's estate and develop a large personal library. Stockton served Princeton as a member of the Board of Trustees, believing that great changes for the better would occur when the college is sent to the lower house of the assembly, men of more foresight and understanding that they can now boast of. At first, Stockton looked for a solution to the conflicts with Great Britain. He proposed that an American be elected to Parliament. His proposal was not accepted, and the Stamp Act passed, causing Stockton to insist that the English Parliament had no right to tax the Americans. His sentiment grew, perhaps even stronger with time. 10 years later, he wrote a letter entitled, "An Expedient for the Settlement of the American Disputes," in which he warned that if immediate measures were not taken, an obstinate, awful, and tremendous war would ensue. 2 years later, Stockton was elected to the Continental Congress as a representative of the state of New Jersey. The New Jersey delegation arrived just as the debate concerning independence was closing. They asked if some of the arguments could be restated for their consideration. Stockton was especially impressed by the argument of one particular person and said, "The man to whom the country is most indebted for the great measure of independence is Mr. John Adams of Boston." In order to stay in the Continental Congress during the war, Stockton declined a September 1776 appointment as the New Jersey Chief Justice. Congress asked Stockton to visit the Northern Army and report on its condition. Stockton saw firsthand the hardships which the soldiers were facing. They were marching along with cheerfulness, but great part of the men barefooted and bare-legged. "There is not a single shoe or stocking to be had in this part of the world, or I would ride 100 miles through the woods and purchase them with my own money." Stockton, who was captured and imprisoned by the British, died at a young age. Before Stockton could return home, the British had invaded New Jersey. Although he moved his family safely to Monmouth County, he was captured on the night of November 30th and put in a cold jail in Perth Amboy. Later, he was transferred to a New York prison. Prisons were a most inhumane part of the Revolutionary War because both sides were not equipped to handle large numbers of captives. In 1777, Congress negotiated Stockton's release, but the imprisonment had taken its toll on his health. He returned to Morven to find his home and expensive personal library burned and ruined. The imprisonment left Stockton an invalid and forced him to rely on friends for support. On February 28th, 1781, at 51, Richard Stockton died. After Cornwallis surrendered in October, Mrs. Stockton wrote a poem of celebration and sent it to General Washington. Washington wrote his thanks to her, and later, passing through Trenton on the way to his inauguration in New York, heard the ladies of Trenton sing the lyrics of Mrs. Stockton's poem. Welcome, mighty chief, once more.